While they're heading out, I encourage you to turn to Luke chapter 24. Don't forget that book. We'll be in Luke chapter 24, verses 36 to 49 this morning. If you're using the Bibles provided for you in the chairs, you'll find that on page 885. Well, over the next two Sundays, Lord willing, we're going to conclude our sermon series through the Gospel of Luke. We began about a year and a half ago, working our way through Luke's Gospel. And, I've enjoyed it. Hopefully you have as well. It's been kind of insightful. And if we remember, as Luke put pen to paper, he began to write. And he reminded us in the beginning pages of his Gospel that he was well acquainted with all that had taken place. And he was writing, and he had done some research, and he put together this orderly account of eyewitness testimony. And that's what the Gospel is. It's this orderly account of eyewitness testimonies. He wrote down what he had researched and wanted Theophilus, this man that he's writing to understand about who Jesus is. And so from the birth of Jesus through the life of Jesus, his public ministry of healing and teaching, to his betrayal, his trial, his death on the cross, his burial, resurrection, and ascension, from beginning to end, the Gospel is this testimony of who Jesus is, what Jesus has done, and how our lives are transformed by him. And so as we read through the Gospel, we see eyewitness testimony after eyewitness testimony, one person after another, as they see the fact that Jesus is God eternal, that Jesus is the Son of God, that Jesus is the Messiah, that Jesus is the one who came and died for us and has risen again. And as they come into contact with Jesus, their life is transformed. And I've enjoyed going through the book of Luke, and we're going to continue over the next two Sundays to finish up Luke's Gospel and see how lives have been transformed as they come in contact with Jesus. And as we see that, it's a challenge for us. How are our lives impacted by the reality of who Jesus is and what Jesus has done? And so this morning, even as we come to Luke chapter 24, verses 36 through 49, the upper room, as the disciples are there and they're behind closed doors, and Jesus comes to them on that first day after the resurrection, and we see the truth that Jesus has risen, he's alive, and how that then impacts the lives of the disciples. It's also a challenge for us. There's some truths that we must take into account as we consider this passage. So let me kind of paint the scene for you a little bit for kind of catch us up, since we had a week off with Mission Sunday. When we come to verse 36, what's the feeling, what's the sense of what's going on? So in Luke chapter 24, verse 36, as we come to this, just be reminded the disciples have followed Jesus for a couple years. They've left everything to follow him, and he began the journey down to go celebrate Passover. So they left Galilee up in the northern part of Israel. They've traveled down along the Jordan Valley. They've made their way to Jerusalem. And along the way, Jesus has been telling them that the Son of Man must be betrayed. He'll be handed over. He'll be put to death and will rise on the third day. And they didn't get it. They didn't understand it. But he's been talking about this persecution that's coming. And as they're traveling to Jerusalem, they know there's this shadow of opposition that's been growing. And so there's this tension and feeling. And the disciples even voice that in the other Gospels. We see them say, why are we going to Jerusalem? Shall we go there and die? Thomas even uses those words. Okay? So they know they've got a feeling what's coming, but they get there, and as they're there, then the Sunday before Passover, the day that the lambs are set aside for the Passover celebration, Jesus rides into Jerusalem on the back of a donkey, fulfilling Old Testament prophecy about your king coming, riding on the donkey, a victorious parade of the king in peace, and the people are shouting hosannas. It's a messianic celebration of the king. Only a few days later, though, Jesus is betrayed by one of them. They scatter. They all run. Peter decides he's going to follow at a distance, and he follows as Jesus has been arrested, but then he's there, and out of fear, three times he cries out, "I don't even know the man." We're told he weeps bitterly. They stood at a distance, and they watched as Jesus was put on a cross. They experienced the 3 hours of darkness, and they saw their teacher, their Lord, their friend, the rabbi, die. You watch him being taken off of a cross, and his body is placed in a tomb. And then the Sabbath day, one of the longest Sabbath days, takes place. And then on the first day of the week, all of a sudden, the women come back excited, confused, joyfully saying something about the tomb is empty, and angels told them Jesus is risen. And Peter and John, they run to the tomb and they look, and that Jesus' body's not there, but the grave clothes are still there. They go away believing but not understanding. They're confused, they're bewildered. They come back, and then as the day presses on, two of the disciples are on their way, not of the 12, but two other disciples on their way to Emmaus, and Jesus appears to them, and Jesus unpacks all the Old Testament scriptures and points out from Genesis to Malachi how the scriptures spoke about him and speak about the Messiah. They run back to the disciples, and they come, and they find out before they even start to share, they find out that Jesus also appeared to Peter, and there's all these things that are coming in, and they're now, John tells us, behind a locked door, because how are the Jewish leaders going to respond when they find the tomb is empty? What are they going to do? So they're excited, because this is unexpected news. They're excited. They're confused. They're bewildered. They're scared. And that brings us to verse 36. And so let's read through this and then take note of four different truths that we need to take note of. So Luke chapter 24, verse 36 through 49. As they were talking about these things, Jesus himself stood among them and said to them, "Peace to you." But they were startled and frightened and thought they saw a spirit. And he said to them, "Why are you troubled? Why do doubts arise in your hearts? See my hands and my feet, that it is I myself. Touch me and see. For a spirit does not have flesh and bones, as you see that I have." And when he had said this, he showed them his hands and his feet. And while they were disbelieved, while they still disbelieved for joy and were marveling, he said to them, "Have you anything here to eat?" They gave him a piece of broiled fish, and he took it and ate it before them. Then he said to them, "These are my words that I spoke to you while I was still with you, that everything written about me in the law of Moses and the prophets and the Psalms must be fulfilled." Then he opened their minds to understand the scriptures and said to them, "Thus it is written that the Christ should suffer and on the third day rise from the dead, and that repentance and forgiveness of sins should be proclaimed in his name to all nations, beginning from Jerusalem. You are witnesses of these things. And behold, I am sending the promise of my Father upon you. But stay in the city until you are clothed with power from on high." Let's pray together and then take a look at four truths for us to consider this morning. Father, thank you for your grace. Thank you for recording for us this moment when you stood among the disciples in the midst of the confusion and excitement and fear of that first day. Lord, that they might know that you were alive. You've risen from the dead and alive to reign forevermore. And that you've given us a commission that we are to proclaim the truth of the resurrection, to proclaim repentance and forgiveness of sin. Lord, may we be faithful to respond to your word today. Lord, let your spirit be at work in us. In Jesus' name, amen. The theme for this sermon series throughout the Gospel of Luke has been, "So that you may know." Right there in the kind of the graphic for the series. And it comes from the opening verses of Luke's gospel, where he writes to this man named Theophilus, and he says in Luke chapter 1, verse 4, he said that, "So that you may have certainty concerning the things that you've been taught." Right? In other words, that you may know, that you might know for certain the things that you've been taught about who Jesus is and what Jesus has done. And we can pick up, I would encourage you to turn over to Acts chapter 1. This is, you could almost say it's Luke part 2. Luke wrote the book of Acts, and in Sunday school, they're working their way through the book of Acts in one of our classes in Sunday school, so I'd encourage you to be there. But I'd say mark Acts chapter 1, because the next 2 weeks are going to be between Luke 24 and Acts chapter 1. Luke is kind of giving us insight into these same days in these two chapters. So in Acts chapter 1, look how he starts. He says, "In the first book," that's his gospel, "O Theophilus," he's referring to the same guy, right, in my In the first book, I've dealt with all that Jesus began to do and teach until the day when he was taken up, after he'd given commands for the Holy Spirit to the apostles from whom he had chosen. Right? So he's referring back to that first book. Here's the first book. I wrote that first book so that you would know all that Jesus did. And now I'm writing again so that you know all that the apostles have done. Right? And then verse 3, we kind of get a clue now into where he's going. And the fact that we don't have a faith that is a leap of faith. The Christian faith isn't without reason. Notice what Luke writes in verse 3. He, Jesus, presented himself alive to them after his suffering, after his death, burial, and resurrection, by many proofs, appearing to them during 40 days and speaking about the kingdom of God. So here is Jesus, and Luke's gospel presents for us the life, the death, the burial, the resurrection of Jesus Christ up through his ascension. We'll look at that next week. And it's imperative for us to know, it's imperative for the disciples to know that Jesus was and is alive. He is our risen Lord and Savior. And it's important for us not just to think he is, but to know it. And so Jesus, over those 40 days, appeared to them. And look, he gave them many proofs over 40 days. In fact, as we read the fullness of the scriptures, we know that he appeared to well over 500 of the followers, presenting many proofs of the fact that he's not just a spiritual leader, a great teacher who died and is buried and now is a ghost, but that he truly rose from the dead. And he is physically risen from the dead, and he lives forevermore. And he presented those proofs. And in Luke chapter 24, we have the beginning of that. We already saw it as he appeared to the disciples, the two on the road to Emmaus. But now in verse 36, we begin to see him with the rest of the disciples. They're there in that room, and they're talking about all that's happened throughout the day. And John, in his gospel, John chapter 20, verse 19, tells us that they were in this room and the doors were locked for fear of the Jews. They didn't know how the Jews were going to respond to all that was going on. So they're scared. So the doors are locked. And they're there. They're talking. They're excited. They're confused. They're scared. Talking and sharing all that's happened. I mean, imagine. So trying to think, how do we put ourselves in that place of remembering or thinking about what it must have been like for them? Think about a day when something happened, a massive news story, and you began to hear bits and pieces. As I thought about this, I thought about 9/11. It was one of mine. I know there's a number of you that 9/11 is just history, but many of you remember it as part of your personal history. Elise and I we had our older two daughters, we were in Disney World on that day. And as we're making our way through the park, all of a sudden one of the workers was upset and shared with us that a plane had flown into one of the towers. Man, all of a sudden, we're halfway across the country from home. We're out there. All of a sudden, this news of a plane into a tower. What does that mean? You know. And then a few minutes later, we hear that a plane flew into the other tower. Like, okay, really, what's going on? Half an hour later, the park closes down, and we have to take a shuttle back to our hotel. And along the way, we find out, and we're hearing news now about different things. We get back to our hotel room, and we turn on the TV, and we see the news broadcast from New York, from D.C., from P.A., and all. But pieces of news are coming in. And if you remember what that kind of day is like, right, you're getting bits and pieces from here and there, and you're confused, you're scared, you're asking those kind of questions. What's going on? What does this mean for us? What does it mean for our country? Are we at war? What, you know, all those questions are coming in. It gives us a bit of a picture into what's going on for the disciples. As they meet that night, there's all the reports coming in. Jesus is risen. We saw him. We saw him. We heard this. We've heard this. We heard about the angels. The women told us this. And they're getting all the news, and they're confused. They're scared. They're excited. Their news is good. Ours was tragic. Now, all of a sudden, as they're talking in this room with the doors closed, someone is among them that wasn't there before. Can you imagine what that is like? All of a sudden, there's someone there. I think verse 47 says that they were startled and frightened. I think that's an understatement. The doors are locked. Someone's here that wasn't here before. And their assumption is, must be a spirit, must be a ghost. Jesus understands what's going on in our hearts. Look at his first words, peace, peace with you. He gives them a greeting of peace. He's not coming with rebuke. He's not coming to bring any kind of discipline or punishment on them. He comes with peace. Peace to you. And then notice he understands what's going on in their minds, right? I'm not a spirit. Take a look. Touch. See my hands and my feet? And he extends his hands. They can see the marks from the nails on his hands. Do you see? See, it's me. It's Jesus. Touch me. There's flesh and bone here. I'm not a spirit. I'm not a ghost. This is a resurrected body. This is a physical body. And he gives them that first proof of his resurrection, that he's alive. Death has no hold on him. The grave was not his final destination. And he gives them that first proof. Then notice, right, so that's the first thing. And when he said this, verse 40, he showed them his hands and his feet. And while they, I love this phrase, verse 41, while they still disbelieved for joy and were marveling. I thought about disbelief for joy. It's a weird phrase, isn't it? What does that mean? It's too good to be true. Have you ever had that time when you get the news that's just too good to be true? So for me, and another one, let me just take you on another journey in the past. We started the journey of adoption in 2011, and it was a long, long process. A number of you that were here at the church at the time, you walked that journey with us, and we waited, and we waited. It was 2016. 5.5 years, roughly, later. We had been on the list for a long time, and also I remember sitting in my office, and all of a sudden I got a phone call, and it was our agency, and they said, check your email. I checked my email, and there's this picture of this little boy and little girl looking back at me. Alicia was actually away with Ariana on a trip, and I'm looking at this picture, and I just wept in my office. Why? I disbelieved for joy. It was too good to be true. I was looking in the faces of the two children that would become my son and my daughter. And I couldn't believe it. I called Alicia. I had to call her 3 times. She was out of the country, and she didn't want to answer the phone. I called her 3 times. Finally, I said, you won't believe it. We got a picture. We got a name. It was too good to be true. That's this verse right here. Could this be real? Jesus, is it really you? Are you really alive? I mean, we've heard the news. It's been a confusing day. Is it really you? They disbelieve for joy, and they're marveling. They're still bewildered. They're still not fully getting the picture. And Jesus, once again, we see the wonder and the patience of our Savior. Do you have something to eat? He doesn't need to eat. He has something to eat. Why? Because he wants to give them another proof. A spirit, a ghost, doesn't eat. So he takes the fish and he eats it again. He's giving them a proof of the fact that he is the risen Savior, the risen Lord, and that they can know for certainty that he's alive. What a beautiful picture the Lord gives us here of his patience with us and his joy to prove himself. Jesus continued over the next 40 days to well over 500 people to show himself alive and to give proof after proof after proof so that they would then give testimony to the truth of his resurrection so that we can know that Jesus is alive. He is the risen Savior and Lord. So one of the truths for us as we come to this text is it's a challenge for us. Do you know that Jesus is alive? Your faith is not some leap of faith. It's based upon the evidence of the eyewitness testimony of those who were there and interacted with him and saw him eat and they touched him and they saw the nails in his hands and they gave testimony to it. And so we don't have a blind faith. We have a faith that is based on reason and evidence. And you and I can know for certain he is alive. And our faith is built on that. Second truth for us comes out of the next couple of verses. Then he said to them, verse 44, "These are my words that I spoke to you while I was still with you, that everything written about me in the law of Moses and the prophets and the Psalms must be fulfilled." He goes on to remind them that all that took place, his betrayal, his death, his burial, his resurrection, all of that suffering took place according to God's word. God wasn't surprised by it. In fact, he's reminding them that he had told them this. And back in Luke chapter 9, we see twice it's recorded that he told them exactly what was going to happen. In Luke 18, Luke records for us that he had told them what was going to happen, but they didn't understand it. And now again, he's saying, "These are my words that I told you while I was with you, that this must happen, and it's happening according to the scriptures, according to the law of Moses and the prophets and the Psalms." It's the one time that we see the three parts of the Old Testament recorded. Usually it's just the law and the prophets, and that's the phrase that summarizes all of the Old Testament, from Genesis through Malachi, from the first word of Genesis to the last word of the Old Testament. And what Jesus is saying is, as you look at all of the Old Testament scriptures, they're pointing to me. They're fulfilled in me. All that's taken place is according to what was said must take place. God the Father was not surprised by this. This was the plan of redemption from the beginning. And so he's unfolding this for them. He's showing them that from the very beginning of Scripture all the way to the end of the Old Testament, every word is pointing to what had taken place. It's all pointing to him. And Pastor AJ, 2 weeks ago, as he worked us through the passage on the road to Emmaus, he did a great job of kind of unfolding the Old Testament. I encourage you, if you weren't here 2 weeks ago, go back and watch that sermon online. It's just a reminder from the opening pages of Genesis, and from the moment that Adam and Eve sinned, and there was the promise that God would send one to crush the head of serpent, crush the head of the serpent of Satan, to the last pages of the prophets that spoke of the Messiah yet to come, the anointed one. It's all pointing to Jesus. And we come to this, and this is a great reminder for us, that Jesus never contradicted the Old Testament scriptures. He never disregarded them. Rather, he affirmed them. And there is a movement in some denominations and churches today to say we should detach ourselves from the Old Testament. We don't want to pay attention to the Old Testament. In fact, we're gonna listen to Jesus alone, and where Jesus contradicts the Old Testament, well, we're going to ignore that, or the epistles, and it's all in an excuse and a way to disregard parts of Scripture. But Jesus doesn't, he never contradicts the Old Testament. He never disregards the Old Testament or the epistles. In fact, Jesus affirms them. He says not the smallest letter of the Scriptures will pass away until they're fulfilled. Jesus affirms the Scriptures. We come to the New Testament. Paul then also says that all Scripture is breathed out by God. From Genesis to Revelation, it is all the Word of God. And so it comes with the authority of God, because it is a breathed out Word. It's inspired of God. And therefore, we take all of His Scripture, and to disbelieve or disobey the Word of God is to disbelieve or disobey God Himself. We can't throw away parts of it or detach ourselves from parts of it. It's all God's Word. And Jesus affirms that. And in fact, he's saying that the law of Moses and the prophets and the Psalms are pointing to me. Jesus is the gravitational center of all of Scripture, if you would. The story of redemption flows through Jesus Christ. It's all about his incarnation and his righteous life and his suffering for us and his victory over the grave and his reign, his eternal reign in heaven, and then his earthly reign that's yet to come. It's all about him. We can't discard any of it. And Jesus is affirming the fact that we have the Scriptures, and we're to uphold the Scriptures, and we're to rejoice in the Scriptures. Notice verse 45, and this I love. So he's saying, the words that I spoke, the Scriptures are all about me. Then he opened their minds to understand the Scriptures. Think about this. These are men who grew up going to the synagogue, being taught the Scriptures. Jesus has unpacked the scriptures, but they still didn't fully understand it. And in fact, in John chapter 20, in John's recollection of that night, John says that at one moment, Jesus breathed on them and said, "Receive the Holy Spirit." And I think those two go together with verse 45, that breathing on them the Holy Spirit. Now, 50 days later is the day of Pentecost, when the Holy Spirit will come on them in power. They're going to go out and preach, and we'll consider that more a little bit next week. But here, actually a little bit later in this message, not next week. But here, there's the breathing out of the Holy Spirit. And the Holy Spirit, in 1 Corinthians chapter 2, we're told that it's the Spirit that reveals spiritual things to us. So how do we understand the scriptures? It's more than just, this is more than just a book with words in it. We can, anybody can read it and understand grammatically what's there. But it takes a work of the Holy Spirit in our hearts and our minds so that we read about the risen Savior, and now it makes sense to the point where now my life is transformed by faith in Christ. And so the Holy Spirit was necessary for verse 45 to take place. Jesus helped them to understand the scriptures, the significance of it, as the Holy Spirit illumined their hearts and their minds to understand the scriptures. And he does the same for you and me. See, we approach the scriptures and we understand it's God's word. How do we understand God's word, though? But we only understand it and apply it as the Holy Spirit is at work within us to help us to understand it. We need to study it. We need to read it. We need to pray over it and say, "God, help me understand and apply your word as I come into the scriptures today." So the first truth is know that Jesus Christ is alive. Second thing is understand the scriptures. Read, study, memorize, meditate the scriptures on the scriptures. Be in Bible studies and times where you're being taught the scriptures, and then pray that God, through the ministry of the Holy Spirit, would help you to understand and apply the scriptures in your life. He opened their minds and their hearts that they would understand the scriptures. Look what he says, "This is written, that Christ should suffer." He repeats again what was said about him in verse 46. So know that Jesus is alive. Understand the scriptures. And then the third truth flows out of verse 47, 48. Repentance and forgiveness of sin should be proclaimed in his name, in the name of Jesus, to all nations, beginning from Jerusalem. You are witnesses of these things. In verse 47, Jesus is continuing from the explanation, from the understanding of Scripture, that once we know who Jesus is, once we understand the Scriptures, once the Holy Spirit is work in us to understand it, now the implication of that, the response of that, the necessary response. In other words, for everyone who knows Jesus Christ as Lord and Savior, everyone here who has trusted in Jesus Christ, understands the Scripture, this is the necessary response. It is not something that's optional. This isn't something we just add on later. Our response should be telling others about Jesus. In fact, the purpose of the church is threefold. One, glorify God. We gather, we worship him to glorify him. Two, to be built up in the faith. Three, to evangelize the lost, to tell others about Jesus. We have the greatest news of all time. God created us to be in a relationship with him. He made us, but we as a people, as a human race, rebelled against him, and every one of us is sinners, and therefore we are broken in our relationship with God, and we don't desire to be in a relationship with him in our natural state. We're sinners. We cannot make it right with him. We can't be good enough. You can't do what would be necessary to make it right. Our sin is that grievous to a holy God. The great news is Jesus did it for us. He came. He lived the righteous life. He died in our place. He took our sin upon himself, all of it, completely on himself, paying the penalty for us, bearing the wrath of God on sin. He was put in the grave. He overcame. He lives again so that anyone and everyone who puts their faith in Jesus Christ is fully, completely forgiven of sin and reconciled to God. That is the greatest news of all time. And many of us have never shared it with anybody. We must declare the news. Jesus doesn't even give us an option. Look at verse 47. It's written, Christ should suffer and on the third day rise again. And that repentance and forgiveness of sins should, must be proclaimed in his name to all nations, beginning from Jerusalem. Let me encourage you. Bear with me with this microphone. At least it's working this week. Just doesn't want to stay on my ear right. I have to train the microphone to stay on my ear. Just like we need to be trained to stay on God's ear. And no, that doesn't work. That analogy doesn't work. We have to be trained, though, to speak. Look what he says. Repentance and forgiveness of sin. What is repentance? Repentance literally means to turn around. It means that in our sinful lives, we are going one direction. We're ruled by self. We're in our sinful state where we are self-exalting, self-ruling. We're following and we're making a king of ourself. And repentance is that moment when we see our brokenness, we see our sinfulness, we see God in all of his glory, and we see the fact that we are not right with God. And in that moment, we turn from self-rule and we turn to God and say, Christ is my king. Christ is my savior. I want to live for you. It doesn't mean that we're perfect now. It doesn't mean that we're without sin. We should be battling against sin in our lives. But that moment of repentance, and then the life of repentance, is this turning away from self-rule and turning to Christ's rule in our life. And he says, here's repentance. And we should be proclaiming repentance through how we live and what we say. We're proclaiming this repentance. And then through faith in Jesus Christ, so repentance and belief goes hand in hand. I turn from self and I trust in Christ. That's repentance. And what's the result? Forgiveness of sin. And that forgiveness of sin isn't that I'm now forgiven, that I might continue to clean up my life. It's the proclamation that Jesus did it all. Jesus bore our sin in its fullness, in its completeness. As far as the east is from the west, our sin has been removed from us. God chooses in Christ to make us clean, to make us holy, and he will never bring our sin before us again to condemn us. Romans 8:1, there is now no condemnation for those who are in Christ Jesus. In Christ, our sin is completely dealt with. We are fully adopted, fully accepted, fully loved by God when we're in Christ. We cannot make him love us more. We cannot make him accept us more through our doing of good stuff. And the great thing is we can't make him accept us less because he sees us and welcomes us and greets us through Christ. We are fully welcomed, forgiven, reconciled to God through Jesus Christ. Through our words, through our lives, we must proclaim repentance, belief in Christ, and the forgiveness of sin. That's the gospel message. We're to be faithful in telling others about Jesus. And notice what he says, it's to go to all nations, starting in Jerusalem. Jerusalem for them was their hometown at that place. That's where they're at. In other words, you're going to start right here. And in fact, in Acts chapter 1, if you look in Acts chapter 1, verse 8, he says this. And you remember, go back and forth. You can look. He says, you're going to receive power when the Holy Spirit comes on you. We're going to consider that in just a moment. And you'll be my witnesses in Jerusalem. That's where they're at. And then he expands that a little bit further, Judea and Samaria. Then he goes one step further. And then to the ends of the earth. And that verse is then the outline for the whole book of Acts. Because you're going to see that the church is established in Jerusalem. And about Acts chapter 8, it then scatters throughout Judea and Samaria. And then about Acts 13 then is when Paul and Barnabas go out and begin to spread the church to the ends of the earth. Hey, but what we see here now in Luke 24, where do we go when we proclaim repentance and forgiveness of sin? To all nations, where? Beginning in Jerusalem. Are you proclaiming repentance and the forgiveness of sin in your Jerusalem, in your home, in your workplace, with family and friends, and in your neighborhood? Are you living out the gospel and, when appropriate, speaking to those around you about Jesus Christ for the sake of the gospel? Proclaiming repentance and the forgiveness of sin in your Jerusalem. We're preparing to, Lord willing, take a missions trip to Greece next year. And if you're considering that, one of the questions you're asked is, what missions trips have you been on? What missions journeys have you been on? Why do we ask that question? Well, we really want to know, are you already speaking about Jesus in your Jerusalem? Before you go to Greece and talk to the nations, I want to try to understand a bit of your heart. Are you proclaiming repentance and the forgiveness of sin in your Jerusalem? Maybe that's the one challenge for you today as you hear this message is, number one, I know Jesus is alive. I understand the scriptures. God keeps at work, but maybe I've been silent in my Jerusalem. Who is one person that you need to speak to about Jesus today? Tell others about Christ. One more truth for us to consider, if you would. So first, know that Jesus is alive. Two, understand the scriptures. Three, tell others about Christ. And the fourth one is this: we do it not in our own power, but through the power of the Holy Spirit. Look how Jesus finishes up what he's saying here. Verse 49, behold, I'm sending the promise of my Father upon you, but stay in the city until you're clothed with power from on high. What is that promise from my Father? If you look over in Acts chapter 1, Acts chapter 1, verse 5, Jesus is speaking to his disciples, and verse 4, he says this, and while staying with them, he ordered them not to depart from Jerusalem, but to wait for the promise of the Father. There's the same phrase. Luke kind of draws back on where he was. He's, you know, reminding us of the promise of the Father, which, now he's going to clarify, which he said, you heard from me, for John baptized with water, but you will be baptized with the Holy Spirit not many days from now. So Jesus himself tells us what he means by the promise of the Father. Promise of the Father is the Holy Spirit being poured out upon believers. Right? And so as we would look through the opening pages of the book of Acts now, the disciples, after Jesus ascends to heaven, the disciples stay in Jerusalem. They have times of prayer. They're together over the next 10 days. There's a 10-day gap between the 40th day when he ascends and the day of Pentecost on the 50th day after his resurrection. And in those 10 days, they're praying together. They're going to the temple. They're worshiping God. They're excited. And then on the day of Pentecost, the Holy Spirit comes on them with power. And that's where their power comes for preaching and proclaiming repentance and the forgiveness of sin. They go from being scared and confused, yet excited and locked in a room 50 days later. They boldly proclaim the risen Lord. And the world is changed forever. What makes the difference? The Holy Spirit. Here's the reality that we live with. My words cannot change your heart. I cannot make you a believer in Jesus Christ. I cannot change your mind. I cannot change your heart. I cannot convince you that you need Jesus. I cannot build a church. And we could do some flashy things and get a crowd, but I could not build a church. We understand as elders that this is not our church. We are under shepherds, under Christ, who is the great shepherd, and the Holy Spirit builds his church. The Holy Spirit is the one who must work in my heart as I study and prepare to preach. And I pray before coming up here that my words would be God's words, that the Holy Spirit would speak through me, and the Holy Spirit's working on you, that you would understand, and that you would be convicted, that you'd be transformed through the preaching of the Word of God. We understand that the ministry is all about the Holy Spirit work. And the great thing is, has it ever made you, like, amazed? So, first of all, God is one God in three persons, Father, Son, Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit is the third person of the Trinity. He's eternally God, and yet the Bible tells us that when we trust in Jesus Christ, the Holy Spirit indwells every believer. God, the Holy Spirit, it's not God Jr., this is God in all of its fullness, has taken up dwelling in your life. The Holy Spirit is present with you as a believer in Jesus Christ, and he's at work in your heart to convict you, to teach you, to guide you, to shape your life, to sanctify you, to empower you for acts of service, to speak his word. So as you're thinking about that person that you need to go and talk to, don't just say, I need to do it so I can convince them. It's now, Lord, you need to work in that person's heart that they would hear your word and be softened by it, convicted of it, and trust in Jesus Christ. The disciples didn't go out in their own power. If it was up to them, they'd still be in the upper room hiding, scared, and confused. But God let them understand the scriptures, and he empowered them to proclaim the word of God. And Peter makes a sermon in Acts chapter 2 that by the power of the Holy Spirit brought 3,000 people to repentance that day. Peter didn't do it. The Holy Spirit did. And you and I, we have the privilege. We have the privilege of telling others about Jesus Christ, but we don't do it in our own power. We tell others about Jesus Christ because the Holy Spirit is at work with us. God is at work in our lives. And Lord willing, in the lives of those who hear, that they would receive Christ and be saved. What a wonderful promise and blessing that is. We see the disciples go from being confused and excited, yet bewildered and scared, to assured in their knowledge, to understanding the scriptures, to being bold in their testimony. And the same is true for us. Let us know that Jesus is alive. Let us be so saturated in the scriptures and the Holy Spirit opening our hearts and our minds to understand the scriptures and apply them to our lives that we are able to then go and tell others through the lives we live and through the words we speak of the repentance and faith in Christ and forgiveness of sin that comes through that. And that's rest and trust in the work of the Holy Spirit in our lives and in their lives to bring about a transformation. Let us praise him. What a wonderful little passage of scripture that just opens our eyes to what God is doing. Let us praise him. Let me pray for us. Father, we thank you. Thank you for your word. Holy Spirit, we thank you that you give us understanding of your word, that you are at work in us, that you're at work in the hearts of those whom we preach to. Jesus, we thank you for living and dying for us and being raised from the dead and living now and interceding on our behalf and the promise that you're coming again. Lord, we rejoice in you. Find us faithful. Encourage us, strengthen us, empower us. Lord, be at work in us that we might proclaim the good news of Jesus Christ. And then you work in our hearts and in the hearts of those who hear to trust you. In Jesus' name, amen.
If you have questions about what you've just heard, or if you want to know more about what it means to follow Jesus Christ, I want to encourage you to check out our website, faithbfc.org. If you live in the Harleysville area and you're not part of a local church, we'd love to have you worship with us here at Faith. I look forward to meeting with you personally. But whether you live here or somewhere else, the important thing is to get plugged into a local church where you can grow in your walk with Jesus Christ and help others grow as you serve him.